Hi, I'm Kate Taylor Davis. I'm the Executive Director at Pyramid Atlantic. So Pyramid was founded 40 years ago with the idea that it could be a shared resource for artists in the areas of printmaking, papermaking, and book arts. Today, we are in the Gateway Arts District, truly because local leadership believes in creative placemaking. In 2016, we renovated and moved into the historic arcade building, which had been vacant for many years. This was possible due to a partnership with the City of Hyattsville, who owns the facility and really wanted to see the arts be an anchor in the community. We have 24 artists who have private studio space here, and we also welcome about 250 additional artists annually who work in our community studios. These community studios allow artists access to equipment, space, and resources that frankly would be very difficult to have in a private studio setting. We equip artists with space and tools, we educate adults and young people, and we exhibit in our gallery and in our gift shop. In non-pandemic times, Pyramid sees about 12,000 people annually through our workshops, exhibitions, and our store. We are lucky to be a part of such a robust and thoughtful arts and small business community. We believe that our work is an important part of the local ecosystem that helps make this a great place to visit, a great place to work, a great place to live, and a great place to create.
Good evening, and welcome to all who have joined us for the Prince George's County Cultural Arts Study Community Meeting presentation. This is the third of the Cultural Arts Study Community Engagement Opportunities in which we will discuss the Cultural Arts Study and receive your feedback. My name is Vanessa Akins with the Prince George's County Planning Department, Community Planning Division, and I am one of the project managers for this study. First, I would like to say before we begin that due to the current circumstances with COVID-19, we are conducting this meeting virtually utilizing the Microsoft Teams platform, and that today's presentation and comments will be recorded and posted online. A copy of the PowerPoint will also be posted on our website for download. We ask that during the presentation, you keep your microphone muted and utilize the chat box for technical issues and during our question and comment period. Please see icons below. This meeting will include enhanced features, including breakout rooms for the best possible experience. Please access the meeting by one of the following: web browsers only, Google Chrome, Microsoft Edge, or Internet Explorer. Do not use Safari, Opera, or Mozilla Firefox. If you encounter any issues accessing the breakout rooms during the meeting, staff will be available to assist you as needed. We ask that you please be polite in your questions. Questions or comments that are inappropriate or contain profane language will be deleted. So let's get started. Today's agenda will include our welcome and introductions, an overview of the project, followed by discussion through our breakout room format and questions through the chat box. Further instructions on how to connect through the breakout rooms will be provided after the main presentation. Now, let us introduce our project team. Again, my name is Vanessa Akins, project manager with the Prince George's County Planning Department. I am joined today by my co-project managers, Darlene Watkins.
Good evening, everyone. Again, I'm Darlene Watkins, Division Chief of the Arts and Cultural Heritage Division of the Department of Parks and Recreation in Prince George's County. Thank you for joining us this evening.
And Rhonda Dallas.
Sorry, I was muted. Good evening, everyone. I'm Rhonda Dallas, Executive Director and Chief Curator for the Prince George's Arts and Humanities Council.
And members of our respective entities have joined us. I also want to acknowledge the following individuals: Delegate Mary Lehman, who has joined us from the District 21. Also, let me acknowledge Chair of the County Council, Councilmember Kelvin Hawkins, and our MMTC leadership, Elizabeth M. Hewlett, Chair of the Prince George's County Planning Board. We send a warm welcome to all our elected officials and agency directors who have joined us this evening. We thank you for being here. We are so pleased to be working with Laura Cultural Resources, who will be working with us on all throughout this exciting initiative. I now turn the meeting over to Laura Cultural Resources and others who will present our presentation this evening. Thank you for joining in.
Thank you, Vanessa. My name is Joy Bailey Bryant, and I have the honor of leading our wonderful team working with the Prince George's County Cultural Arts Study. Our team includes Eve Moros Ortega, who is our project manager, Tiffany Lyons, who is our research consultant, John Stover from JS&A, who are an economic development firm, and Stan Wall from HRNA Advisors, who are really working throughout the county and helping us to really connect the work of the cultural arts study with many of the other plans that are happening across the county. Let's talk a little bit more about why we're doing a cultural arts study and what it is. The cultural arts study is a comprehensive assessment of the diverse arts and cultural ecology in Prince George's County. This is important because we really want to understand more about what is happening in the county. So who's a part of creating it? Well, you just met the wonderful triumvirate of Prince George's County Planning Department and Department of Parks and Recreation, as well as the Prince George's Arts and Humanities Council. Additionally, we have a steering committee, arts advisors, and key stakeholders, as well as a broad spectrum of county voices who are taking part in many of these community conversations, just like we are having tonight, as well as multiple interviews and other ways of engaging with people across the county. Everyone is invited to participate, and we really need to hear from you. We also have a survey, which you will be hearing about and have a link from throughout this presentation. So if you are able to take the survey, as well as invite friends to our community conversations that we are holding each month, we absolutely encourage you to do so. So why a cultural arts study? There are five big reasons. We want to explore the ways that arts, culture, and entertainment can play a role in shaping the lives of Prince George's County residents and their communities. We need to identify policy changes that will ensure the cultural arts are included across all sectors. And ensuring that arts and culture is included across sectors means that arts and culture are not a silo off to the side. Instead, we have creativity helping us to achieve safer streets in our transportation department. We have creativity helping us to achieve higher goals with our educational system. We have creativity working in healthcare to make healthcare initiatives more clear to understand and encouraging people to participate in healthcare opportunities. There are many other ways that arts and culture can impact all the sectors of our lives in Prince George's County. And we want to hear from you about creative ways you've been either doing that or thinking about doing that. With that information, we want to increase opportunities for public art, community art projects, and infrastructure support for artists. And then finally, we want to leverage arts and culture as a game-changing revitalization strategy to assist in improving the quality of lives in our communities across the county. So tonight, we are literally talking about the ways that arts and culture can make our places better. We throw around the word placemaking, but that's actually what it means. It means thinking about the spaces in which we are living and how can we make those better. Placemaking capitalizes on arts and cultural assets. And we call these arts and cultural assets because that is exactly what they are, places and opportunities to make our communities better. Through placemaking, arts and culture impacts all of the elements that you see listed here. Placemaking draws from the potential and inspiration of creating public spaces to promote people's health, happiness, and well-being. Remember when I talked about quality of life earlier? Arts and culture really has a powerful impact on our quality of life, particularly this placemaking thing, understanding where you are and really identifying, having a real identifier for the places in which we are and feeling proud of that. Placemaking is a multifaceted approach to planning, design, and the management of spaces. So tonight, yes, we are talking about placemaking. How are we doing this whole cultural arts study? We started in the summer of 2020 with a massive background review, really trying to understand more of what was happening across the county. We started our stakeholder interviews, and now we are in these community meetings. So as I said, tonight we're talking about placemaking, about the ways that we can make our places better and identify our places better. We also have our cultural participation survey. You see the link in the chat. Please go there early and often and encourage your friends to do so well, friends, family, and neighbors. From this information, we will be producing an economic development report and then a presentation of the key findings. So we're going to compile all of this information and present that and through a draft cultural art and then create a draft cultural arts study. Finally, we will share that information in a community meeting and produce the final cultural arts study. So I introduced a little bit more about placemaking earlier, but I think it's important for us to just think about what we're talking about today and what it really can mean. The image that you see on the side to your right is what I like to call a modern totem. Ancient totem poles were actual markers of place. They told people when they arrived in a location what was important to those communities. So when you look at vibrant images like the one you see on the right, you see what is important to this community. It is a marker of this space and this place and these people. So when we talk about placemaking, we really want to leverage arts and culture in increasing creative activity and creating distinct senses of place with everywhere in each of the spaces where we're able to do this across the county. Arts and culture improve physical and social character of an area and promote enduring social change. So if you keep that image of that totem in your mind, what is the depiction of your community? What will be the marker of your place? That is what we want to talk about. How do you make your place better? And how can you make your place better through arts and culture? So to talk a little bit more about how that is currently happening in Prince George's County, I'm going to turn this over to Rhonda Dallas.
Thank you, Joy. Thank you. I want to start by saying this is both an inspiring and visioning time for the arts in Prince George's County. Creative placemaking is finally embodied within the county's economic development goals and encouraged across public and private sectors, influencing our county's commercial and community development. We at the Prince George's Arts and Humanities Council have always been at this forefront. For our team, creative placemaking is realized through our community grants program, and please make note, our grant applications are now open on our website. By supporting municipal and grassroots arts and social impact initiatives, and most visibly through public art, which my colleague Darlene can also attest. This current slide highlights the butterfly tree located at the Southern Area Aquatic and Recreation Complex, commissioned by Maryland National Capital Park and Planning Commission, Parks and Recreation Division. Emphasizing the critical role public art plays in impactful creative placemaking, the Prince George's Art in Public Places program, one of the oldest 1% arts programs in the region, focuses on incorporating public art in county-owned buildings such as libraries, fire stations, police stations, administrative buildings, etc. This slide highlights the Laurel Branch Library Project, which commissioned two local art studios, Washington Glass School, which is shown, and Martha Jackson Jarvis Studio, whose installation is located at the side entranceway. This project won the prestigious American Institute of Architects Award. Yes, indeed, we've got talent in Prince George's County. PJC manages the Art in Public Places program, and we encourage local artists and artist teams to apply for these opportunities, which are posted on our PJC website. Our public art bus shelter pilot, which is currently an active RFQ on our website, shows the use of public art in a functional capacity, tooling an everyday experience within creative placemaking. The example shown is a prototype commissioned by the Hyattsville CDC and developer Peter Siegel, and the prototype was also supported by PGHC. This bus shelter stands in front of Studio 3807 on Rhode Island Avenue in the Gateway Arts District. The image below is an example of creatively activating a building while still under construction, again at 3807. This site was actually the raw interior shell for the existing food hall, which made the ideal canvas for our curated Arts to Nation digital public art display, celebrating the Gateway Open Studio Tour. The Tag Tool creative team was commissioned as a PGHC International Artist in Residency. Creative placemaking involves collaborative visioning. This installation that's on the screen became a wayfinding piece, bringing a unique identity to 1801 McCormick Drive, which is our administrative building, and a major public-facing corridor where no artwork previously existed. Stay tuned, this is about to expand with the Destination Art Walk experience. The installation on the screen was our first environmental public art project in partnership with the Prince George's Department of Environment, which aligned perfectly with the art and social equity practice exemplified by Artworks Now, based in Hyattsville, the commissioned artist team. The concept design, wind vane, and the helenium autumnale was actually inspired by homeschooled preschoolers when asked to draw a better world by Artworks teaching artists. Now, how cool is that? Here's another example of pairing art and social justice with messaging and reflections displayed through a community chalk art project led by the City of Bowie's Arts Committee, which we supported. Our last example reflects the resilience of the creative placemaking, even in a COVID pandemic. Inside Out Studio at Red Dirt Studio was Margaret Boozer and her team's pivoting reaction to produce art and support their studio artists through these challenging times. The adjacent image is one of our temporary public art installations around the perimeter of D Park 3311, our creative co-working space in program partnership with the Gateway CDC Media Arts Lab and the City of Mount Rainier. Now back to Joy.
Actually, I'm going to speak. Thank you, Rhonda. My name is Eve Morris-Ortega, and I'm so honored to be here tonight. And we wanted to also provide some examples. Those are so inspiring, Rhonda, the ones from Prince George's County. And we're going to present some from around the country to show some additional strategies for placemaking to create more vibrant communities, to inspire the discussion we're going to have soon with you. So the Kentucky Center for African American Heritage in Louisville applied creative placemaking to help community development by using art to address issues of public safety. The center collaborated with a local collective of diverse artists to lead public workshops blending West African and Appalachian arts, such as looking at the roots of the banjo, an instrument connected to both cultures, and really emphasizing that identity within Kentucky. The Mayor's Office of Safe and Healthy Neighborhoods invested in this project, which worked with youth in areas of the city classified as zones of hope that were higher poverty areas to present public workshops and performances to decrease youth violence, providing an alternative activity and to strengthen the creative identity of the community. It's notable that this center has a relatively modest budget, around $500,000 a year, half from public funding and the other half mostly from earned income, such as rentals. And a lot can be done, even with modest means. So this is a much different project, much bigger. The Over-Underpass in Greensboro centers on public art and reviving infrastructure to build connections between neighborhoods to create a stronger sense of place. For decades, the overpass of a railroad line in Greensboro formed a barrier between its city center and its historically underserved neighborhoods to the south. And the underpass beneath had been abandoned since the 1970s. So this was part of a broader city plan to better define Greensboro's downtown with a 4-mile multi-use greenway called Downtown Greenway. And this overpass and underpass area presented an opportunity to create an exciting and inviting environment that would allow neighborhood residents to more easily access downtown and to create a unique destination for visitors and residents alike. Public art along the pedestrian route was key to creating this welcoming environment, with art installations planned at key sites to animate the greenway and enhance relationships between neighborhoods and businesses. This is a public-private partnership with a lead organization called Action Greensboro, which was formed in 2001, working with numerous government agencies, including Parks and Recreation, Planning, Policy, and Transportation departments, and with support from local foundations and corporate supporters. The overall greenway has secured about $200 million in completed and planned investment. The Creative Entrepreneurship Program in San Jose is about tapping artists as entrepreneurs to create a sense of place with artist-initiated festivals, music venues, and art fairs. And it's part of a broader effort by the City of San Jose to make its downtown a central destination for Silicon Valley by animating that downtown and neighborhood cultural nodes with cultural happenings and wide-ranging artist involvement. The Creative Entrepreneur Institute is led by the Office of Cultural Affairs, collaborating with economic development and community development agencies and the city's housing, planning, and transportation departments. These cross-agency partnerships provide artists business training, professional development scholarships, a web-based resource guide, and commissions for artists on public transportation and other public art projects to make that revitalization possible working with individual artists. Phoenix, Arizona provides another example of using art and infrastructure in a wide variety of public facilities and places. The City of Phoenix Public Art Program is one of the most active and diverse municipal art programs in the U.S. It was created in 1986 through an ordinance that allocates 1% of the city's annual capital improvement program to public art projects. And over 20 years, they've invested over $30 million in public art, installing it at highway underpasses, freeway overpasses, pedestrian bridges, around canals and trails, neighborhood parks, and around recycling centers even. The 2018 to 23 public art plan has a budget of around $12 million with 30 funded projects, 5 new and 25 continuing. And those include projects at water facilities, street improvements, canal crossing, and even the Phoenix Airport. So it's really about improving quality of life and creating a more livable place for Phoenix residents, and also providing residents opportunities to shape those local art projects by providing input at public art planning meetings and making Phoenix a place that will attract new residents, businesses, and visitors. We also want to provide some regional examples. So Meet Me at the Triangles in Montgomery County was installed in Wheaton Town Square last October after years of planning as the capstone of a major civic placemaking project in Wheaton. This is an example of public art that is both beautiful and functional, and it can really make a place a place. In this case, by providing a badly needed public gathering spot. Meet Me at the Triangles is the focal point of a new town square in Wheaton, which is part of a larger project, the Wheaton headquarters, a new county office building that represents the largest public and private investment in Wheaton since the construction of the Metro Rail. From a planning perspective, this investment reflects Wheaton's evolution from suburban residential to auto-oriented retail to an urban downtown with a more multicultural community. It also very specifically bolsters the identity of Wheaton, as the name itself of this sculpture comes from the artist's research, referring to a time when the Wheaton Triangle was indeed a meeting place. And it was created with a team of local artists incorporating stories about Wheaton in the design of the sculpture. And our last example is Dance Place 8th Street Arts Park in the District of Columbia. And this is about bringing culture from inside the walls of a cultural institution to the outside, figuratively and literally. And in short, Dance Place transformed an underused slab of asphalt next to their studios as a vibrant public space, including colorful surfacing, a convertible outdoor stage, public arts commissions by local artists, a sprinkler for kids to play with, as well as a bike rack and bicycle repair station. And to give a little context, so they're located in Brooklyn, Dance Place, a neighborhood with high poverty and unemployment. They're a cultural center that runs a dance school and offers community arts and dance programming in partnership with various schools in the area. And in 2009, the DC Department of Housing and Community Development created an affordable housing development in partnership with Dance Place called the Brooklyn Art Space Loft on the lot adjacent to Dance Place Center. But there was a vacant alleyway between the Dance Place and those lofts, and that was what was transformed into this park. To create, and it became part of the Dance Place campus. To create this campus, they employed a community-based design process composed of artists, business owners, civic association leaders, government representatives, including graffiti artists, to bring ideas to life. That park now hosts events such as dance classes, presentations, gardens, and arts creation events. For example, they've worked with the DC Department of Energy and Environment to offer a garden club and related youth and community classes. It's funded in a variety of ways, including a $500,000 grant from the Kresge Foundation, about $70,000 from the DC Commission on Arts and Humanities, and contributions from private donors and corporations. And really, it's an extension of the of Dance Place's core mission of building community through performances and taking that outside to create a broader sense of place outside their facility. And now we're going to move to the breakout room. Sorry, go ahead, Vanessa.
Well, thank you, Eve. That was great information. So the first part of this meeting has now concluded. We will now be entering breakout rooms to have a more focused, facilitated discussion to get your feedback. So we want to thank everyone who joined us in our breakout discussion. There were some great comments that we received. So what's next? We want you to go in and fill out our survey on PGCCS study. You can link on this link or go to the planning department's website and look up the cultural arts study. So again, visit https://bit.ly/PGCCA study. If you would like, you can volunteer to host a community culture circle with friends and family about experiencing arts and culture in Prince George's County. It only takes a few of you to be able to decide you want to have that community culture circle and provide us with more information. We also want you to stay tuned to our upcoming meeting on Thursday, April 8th, so mark your calendar at 7 p.m., where we will talk about arts and connectivity. I assure you, you will be interested in that conversation. If you would like and have more questions, please contact us at our website at pgcas@ppd.mncppc.org. Again, contact us at pgcas@ppd.mncppc.org. We want to thank you for your participation, and we really want you to stay involved as we continue through this process, looking at engaging with you as citizens in terms of the cultural landscape of the county. So we ask you to stay tuned for our next meeting again on April 8th. And on behalf of all of us, I believe many of us are still on, my co-project managers are still on, that we want you to stay involved, and we thank you for your participation. So good night, enjoy the cold, beautiful ice snow weather out there. I enjoy it, but we ask you to please join us and come back. And as you heard, we have a lot of different opportunities for you to become involved in many of our projects that we have within the planning department. So we say stay tuned and please visit our website. Good night, and be safe.
Thank you, everyone. Good night.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Stay healthy.